Jurassic World Evolution is a game that comes with big expectations. It's been just over 15 years now since Jurassic Park Operation Genesis released, and it's not just a dinosaur park builder we've been lacking, but a true Jurassic Park game at all. That is an incredible amount of pressure on a game that has a fairly short development cycle, and we'll come back to that a little later. For reference sake, as I write this review, I have 32 hours in the game, I've completed every single mission in the game, I've maxed out the genome for every single dinosaur, and I've 5-starred 4 out of the 5 deaths. Damn you, Isla Pena. Today we're going to cover essentially every aspect of the game, so get comfortable. Let's start with the basics. Jurassic World Evolution is a park builder game with two main focuses, guests and dinosaurs. Unlike the crazy creativeness of Frontier's previous title, Planet Coaster, the game instead focuses much more deeply on the management of these two groups. Your dinosaurs require the right population, the right social groups, the right environment and the right genetic combinations to reach their maximum potential and happiness. Your guests need good ways to see these dinosaurs, of course, but they also need to be able to shop, to have fun, to feed, to rest, to feel safe, and to get around your park easily. The balance of these two aspects is the driving force of Jurassic World Evolution's gameplay, and by mastering both you'll be able to progress along the 5 deaths, unlocking new research and, most importantly, new dinosaurs as you go. Adding to these basal systems is the addition of a mission and contract system, a way to both introduce a plot to the game and also to bring in some busy work to kill the excessive downtime that's plagued past games like this. The three factions in the game, science, security and entertainment, all compete for your attention by presenting unique unlocks and missions on each island. And if you really want to build the best park possible, you're going to want to level up the reps of all three factions on every island you play. You'll do smaller contracts for each faction as you go, release such and such dinosaur, maintain a high profit level, don't have any power outages, that sort of thing, and also bigger missions that can, especially on the later islands, be surprisingly difficult, having you wrangle multiple large dinosaurs in chaotic conditions. So that is basically how the game functions, that is your day-to-day gameplay. But is it any good? Let's look at the stars of the show first, the dinosaurs. Thankfully, they're pretty gorgeous in model, animation, sound, the lot. Some of them ripped straight out of Jurassic Park like the Dilophosaurus or the Tyrannosaurus Rex, whereas some are Frontier's own designs that range from the creative, the Deinonychus, to the surprisingly accurate, the Mementosaurus. Regardless of your personal preferences, there's a dinosaur here for everybody, and I had an immense amount of fun watching them emerge from the incubators for the first time into my park. The Brachiosaurus for me in particular, it steps slowly out of the incubator and lets out this bellowing call just as the music swells, and it's a moment that really never ever got old for me. It's stunningly beautiful, it really is. These creatures should be the star of your playthrough, and in appearance at least, they are. In behaviours is where they start to fall a little flat, unfortunately. They certainly do show some interesting ones, and I had one particularly memorable moment during my playthrough wherein a Deinonychus tested an electric fence, realised it couldn't escape through it, and then came back later to break out of the one single portion of non-electrified fence in my paddock. An area I didn't even realise I had. I'm unsure if it's by design, but I loved seeing it, and if you don't watch them too long, the dinosaurs appear intelligent and alive. If you do watch them too long, however, you'll realise there's a fairly limited set of behaviours in the game, and some design choices that at first glance don't make a whole lot of sense. Your herbivores will graze and occasionally socialise, but they'll never sleep. The socialising is always in a weird little triangle, and the grazing doesn't increase their hunger level, which might not seem like a big deal until you realise it renders a true Site B mode, without human intervention, impossible. The carnivores contain some exciting battle animations, but the 1v1 nature of the combat system and the incredibly limited number of animations means they always play out very similarly. Watch a Deinonychus and a Velociraptor fight and they'll basically mirror each other perfectly. Watch a Spinosaurus or a T-Rex or any other large carnivore take down its prey and they'll finish it off with basically the exact same animation. These are still really exciting to watch at first, they truly are, as the animations are expertly done. But there simply isn't nearly enough of them to make the dinosaurs interesting in the long term. The dinosaurs sound and look different, but they don't really act different. If you want to keep these dinosaurs happy, you'll need to balance the grassland and forest in your exhibit as well as the population, i.e. the total number of dinosaurs, and the social need, i.e. how many of the same species the dinosaur needs. I don't know how else to say it other than the balance for these needs is in desperate need of revision, and I hope it'll be addressed in the upcoming day one patch. The problems really centre around the dinosaur's comfort level. This is a bar that will drop if you fail to account for any of the aforementioned needs, and as soon as it drops into a red section, that dinosaur will start to look for a way to break out. It's a fine system on paper, as it means you've got to keep an eye on all of your dinosaurs, account for their needs, and it's a way for the most powerful creatures to be especially aggressive because they have a very low bar for comfort. In reality, it's incredibly frustrating at times. Some dinosaurs have a high social need, and if you're even one short of their population, just briefly, perhaps even as you're making that fourth Mosasaur, you can very quickly end up with a rampaging herd on your hands. This is a mild irritant that can be planned around with careful management, but the environment cannot. This was a persistent problem in my playthrough, with the sauropods in particular, some of which have a particularly high forest need, as what they would do is approach a fence or a gate, suddenly realise they're not surrounded on all sides by forest, and proceed to try to break out. As far as I can tell, this environmental need is based on a radius around the dinosaur rather than the total exhibit they're placed in, and not only is this incredibly unnecessarily limiting for exhibit design, but it leads to situations wherein even in an exhibit filled to the brim with forest, a dinosaur may claim to be lacking and proceed to break out. The problem with the system is that it punishes you for going for high-value, exciting dinosaurs, as it really only takes a short time for them to reach their comfort breaking point and want to escape. This would be easily fixed, it really would. All that is especially a shame because the genetic modification system in the game should, in theory, make for some exciting dinosaur interactions. By plugging in a different set of genes from different animals into your dinosaurs, you can customize skin color, you can customize a huge range of different statistics. This also lowers their viability, however, increasing the chances of a failed incubation. It's a very interesting risk-reward system that means you'll never be sure of making that top-tier dinosaur until you get particular unlocks near the end of the game. It's a well-implemented system that feels like it could have been pushed maybe just one step further, increasing aggression or defensiveness or how sociable your dinosaurs are and the like. Still, if you have a dinosaur you love, you can treat that one specifically to some extra love and care. This gives each park a layer of individuality it may have lacked otherwise, but I would have liked to see just a little bit more visible impact from the system. It does succeed on the skin front at least too, allowing you to make varied and interesting dinosaur enclosures even though some of the dinosaurs, and for some reason the Velociraptors in particular spring to mind, are given a peculiarly dull set of skins compared to some of the other exciting additions that the other dinosaurs get. The other half of the game mainly concerns managing your guests and the park itself. The latter means building your exhibits, placing down the needlessly large, seriously you're going to feel it too, incubation centres and managing power supplies. That power management can certainly lead to some frightening moments, as the power to your park can suddenly disappear on you thanks to an encroaching storm or sabotage committed by an ignored faction. This means your facilities drop and of course your dinosaurs are liable to escape. These escaped dinosaurs are at first terrifying, as even the herbivores are more than capable of barreling into your park guests and murdering them all, basically. And actually, throughout my own playthrough, it was definitely the herbivores that easily caused me the most stress, which is a really nice change. Having your power station shut down and having to manually hop into your jeep and zoom around the island to try to turn them back on before your Indominus Rex breaks out and wreaks havoc is definitely an exhilarating moment right through the playthrough. The game's mission system has also been a success. Past games like this have suffered from long periods of downtime where all you could do was watch the day play out. Here in Evolution, you can essentially always get a new contract or mini-mission if you so choose from one of the three aforementioned factions. Now many of these contracts aren't particularly exciting in and of themselves, but they may make you start researching a dinosaur you hadn't considered, or shore up a weakness in your park design. The leaders of these factions, the ones giving you these missions, are all relatively interesting characters who have their own distinct personalities, and as I've said, some of the later missions are truly difficult, which was a nice surprise. I do wish there was more long-term repercussions for siding with a faction, and I wish it wasn't so easy to flip-flop between them on every island, as I think this would have greatly increased the replayability of the game. But for what they are, I'm very glad to have this system. Where it ties into the overarching plot of Evolution is where this system starts to fall down. Now if you want to totally avoid anything about Evolution's story, just skip forward 30 seconds or so, but really there are no spoilers here anyway. A lot has been said about Evolution being a tycoon game with a true story. I myself have hyped it up before release, as I was really excited to experience a Jurassic Park story across these islands whilst I was playing the game. Unfortunately, that story does not exist. I don't know what else to tell you, it isn't there. Dr. Wu will pop up from time to time and suggest a hint of a plot about using the dinosaurs for warfare, carrying on his work from Jurassic World, but other than that, the story literally doesn't exist. I can't even begin to tell you what the overarching plot for the science and entertainment trees are, or what the deeper motivations of their respective leads are other than I like science and I like money. For what it's worth, the end of the game suggests the plot isn't quite done yet, and I strongly suspect it'll be expanded in the future, if not with the Fallen Kingdom DLC, then with something else. But for now, it is one of the most disappointing aspects of the entire game for me, and it is not something that should have been hyped up pre-release. My bad. Now, as for your guests themselves, you'll satiate their basic hunger and rest and transport needs with a surprisingly large variety of different buildings, including things like bowling alleys, hotels, and monorail stations for transport. It's actually quite a deep system, wherein you can control how many staff members work at each individual shop, the items you sell at that shop, and the price of said items. By selling the right things, providing enough hotels, and weaving monorail tracks around your park to handily highlighted spotlights, you can ensure your facility rating levels up as much as your dinosaur rating, and get that 5-star park you covet. It's definitely more in-depth than similar games of this nature, though I believe, and this is completely personal preference, there is perhaps too much focus on that aspect of the game as opposed to the dinosaurs themselves, but your mileage may well vary. The placement of buildings that you use for this does present a small problem with it, however, and that's the terrain management. In Evolution, you can control the terrain with a basic set of tools that lets you raise hills, carve out valleys, flatten and smooth areas, and also place down trees, grassland, and water. It's not the most complex system, but it's definitely enough for a game like this at this point in time. Except when it comes to placing buildings. They will over and over again tell you that the terrain isn't suitable for a building because of an ever so slight slope, and it makes it frustratingly difficult to build a neat and well-controlled park without basically bulldozing and flattening the whole thing from the get-go. I really enjoy the management aspect of the game, and I love that it's been fleshed out so much, but this one problem certainly made it just a little bit tiresome by the end of the game. All of this I've mentioned, of course, takes place on the Five Deaths and Isla Nublar, the sandbox mode of this game. Being able to play across the Five Deaths is really exciting. Seeing islands like Matanceros and Muerta come to life in ways that have literally never ever been done before was a great choice for the game, and I was always very excited to unlock a new island and experience it. They all have a relatively distinct personality as well, thanks to their different shapes, different weather systems, and set times of day. I know that's a system many of you disagree with, but I find it to be interesting rather than a negative. Penna is small and dark and filled with storms, whereas Tucano is bright, sunlit, and opens up into an interesting shape. I do feel these personalities could have been pushed further. Sorna in particular is, despite being large in actual buildable area, still basically the same as the other islands, despite the demonstrably different environment it has in the film, and the promise of endemic wildlife is actually pretty disappointing in reality. Similarly, the twisters that plague you in the latter stages of the game are threatening at first, but you quickly realise that they basically do nothing. I've seen twisters sit on top of my park guests as they happily walk on by, and I've never seen them harm a dinosaur either. Sure, you'll have a broken fence or two, but that's something you're going to experience pretty often anyway. Some of you at home will inevitably be happy with this, but for me personally, it just felt a little limp and disappointing. Jurassic World Evolution is the basis of a great game, hamstrung by odd design decisions, likely brought about by the short development cycle. It truly feels like the game needs another 6 months cooking to be the game we, and if we're honest, probably Frontier, really want it to be. For every good thing, there's a caveat. The dinosaurs are beautiful, but they're lacking in both behaviour and animation variety. The missions are interesting, but there's no replayability to them, and the plot is bare bones at best. The islands all have their own personality and challenge, but space is at too much of a premium for most of the game, and the twisters are ineffective. The tone of this review has probably sounded incredibly negative, and that's only because I want to make sure you're all aware of what you're truly buying with this game. I owe it to you, myself, and indeed the developers themselves, to be honest. Saying all of this, everything I've said, I'd like to close on a positive note. Despite my frustrations with the game, I did actually really enjoy my time with it, and ended up happily binging those 30 plus hours in just a handful of days. Not because I had to for this review, I had plenty of time, but because I deeply wanted to. I couldn't stop myself playing, I was just enjoying myself too much. The dinosaurs truly are beautiful, and I still to this day, 2 weeks later, get the same chills when a Brachiosaurus emerges, or the same sense of impending doom when an Indominus Rex starts to beat on an enclosure wall. I so badly, so badly want this game to be incredible, and at times it really feels like it's on the cusp of being so. If you wanted a sequel to JPOG, this is it. It really is. It's a fun and immersive dinosaur park builder that perhaps promised a little too much and needed another round of development before being shipped. But hey, that's the nature of game development. Just trust me when I say I criticize because I love, and I love what this game could turn into. On that point, and to finish on one more beacon of hope, it's just who I am, because I'm sure some of you will be a little disappointed with what I've said today. Frontier are, in my opinion, one of the finest game developers out there right now. It's a company filled to the brim with lovely people who clearly, so very clearly adore Jurassic Park. You can hear it in the gorgeous music and the booming T-Rex roar. You can see it in the animation of a Dilophosaurus frill opening, or the way a raptor will pounce on a fleeing Edmontosaurus in a pretty damned baller way. And you can read it in the in-depth in-gen files that you'll unlock throughout the game, giving you a really deep look into the history of the franchise. This is a company with a long history of game support, with both of their previous titles still being shown love to this very day, and I inherently believe that Jurassic World Evolution will be a better game a year from now. Give them time, offer constructive and helpful criticism, and until then, enjoy the first true Jurassic Park game we've had in well over a decade. A lot of the stuff I've mentioned today, the negatives, are busy work. The dinosaurs are still there, that feeling is still there. Go and enjoy it. Thanks for joining me as always, folks. I hope you've enjoyed my day full of gameplay today, and if you want to keep up to date on my full playthrough, future news, and a bunch of interesting bonus videos I have planned for Evolution, please do remember to throw a like and a subscribe. Cheers, much love, as always. Bye-bye. Quick little shout out at the end, this video and others like it would not be possible at all without the support of you guys watching me at home and also everyone on this Patreon page right here who supported me in the last month. If you want to help out as well, you can do so at patreon.com/bestinslot. Every little really helps. Cheers.